I mean, I think it also takes us to a discussion saying that how do you see water? Is water a purely local resource? I would argue that water is both a local resource and a non-local resource at a basin scale. Now, if I say that a local community has 100% right over utilizing the way it wants, the entire water which flows through its doorstep, there are issues of downstream people, which is dependent on the same flows. So unless we capture the complexity of seeing water as both a local and a non-local resource, we don't capture. Now, there are studies after studies today. If you conserve and extract water in the micro watershed development, it has basin level implications. Okay, so what I'm saying that I do believe that the whole principle of subsidiarity is important. The local, the lowest unit should be able to take decisions which it can take. I'm not saying that. So it also brings in the whole issue of water rights. I thought Seema will bring in later. Now, does the local community has right to say, or a right over water, entire flow which goes through its, listen, at which order of stream which you are talking about, what is the type of thing, and what is the type of downstream dependency and things. So I think we also need to take that into account when we say that there is an absolute right for the local community to decide the way it wants, because water has certain type of unidirectionality, and the relationship between the upstream people and the downstream people asymmetric. Unless we take into account this whole romanticizing about local community, I think I find it problematic. Though I agree with the spirit which you are saying, the local community should have a larger say in deciding its own type. But then when you say about rights over water, it's saying that if you say water is a fluid resource, you don't get the same amount of water every year. There is connectivity between upstream and downstream, and that relationship is asymmetric because actions of the upstream people can impact on the downstream people, and similarly downstream people's action cannot always affect upstream people. That's why, for example, if an upstream industry is there, it can pollute. That person may not get affected because he is located in the upstream, but the people in the downstream pay the price for it. So unless we capture this complexity of both social relationship, power relationships, and biophysical relationships in a river context between upstream and downstream to say, so instead of that, I would say that we need a much more of a nested institutional framework for the water governance. You should start with the micro watershed or the lowest unit which can take. And today I can tell you watershed after watershed. I mean, some of the issues which you are saying, where is it, successful cases have come up? It is where people have been able to craft certain rules about water extraction, water use, and other type of thing. Now, and also there's an issue of micro-macro matching somewhere. Otherwise, resource availability, even in a basin or a sub-basin, is not the same. Now, are we not talking about, to some extent, I'm not saying it's all absolute concepts, you know, some type of a basin-level equity is involved? Or we say that, so I think there are complex issues. In spirit, I would say that principle of subsidiarity is important. The lowest unit should be able to take most of the decisions. But seeing water as much more of a local and a non-local resource, we should be able to this. So I'm not saying that this should be, in fact, Kerala water policy did give a provision of that type, the draft, saying that except the first two priorities, that is drinking water and agriculture, the remaining water uses each basin. I think Kerala has some small basins. I mean, it's not large basins, some 30 or 35 odd smaller rivers. They gave the flexibility to the river basin, saying that you can decide your the rest of the priorities. So I think there are different ways of engaging with issues of that type. So it's not only just localism, which this. Otherwise, we have slogans, no, gaon ke paani gaon mein. But that does not really, it is good for conservation. It does capture the spirit. But I think after a point, we need to also see water from a little larger perspective. That's what I would say at the moment. I mean, we can differ on this. That's what I said, we have certain positions which we can put forward. But I would say that both these need to be taken. So I would argue for a nested institutional framework building from the micro watershed or a village level or something, going down to in a federated structure which takes decisions on the use, allocation, and various other type of things which is involved. On the water use, I mean, this is an important issue which you raised. I mean, that's a very, issue when you talk about how, to what extent we are going to be flexible, what does, this is not to say that every community should agree to this, no. But it gives you an idea about a different perception, and I agree with you that it cannot be a bottom, top-down approach to saying that everybody should this. And also, why I brought in some of those numbers is that, I agree with you that it's not only scarcity. I mean, scarcity drives most of the supply side solutions today being talked about. But I am saying that even from a supply side point, there are limits today on the system. So there's a social cultural factor, there's equity issues and various other things, and who takes decisions, all these are connected with that. So we need to take both these factors, and I do believe the biophysical characteristics have some bearing on, you know, the institutions, policies, legal systems and governance systems in general. So both should be able to come together.